He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
HIV is one of the best-known viruses in existence. Despite this, compared to some of the other viruses we've covered, our knowledge about HIV is relatively new. Human immunodeficiency virus began circulating and infecting humans long before we knew what it was and where it came from, as with most diseases in human history. But HIV in particular is considered to be one of the most devastating infectious agents to emerge in recent history. The story begins in the early 1980s, when a mysterious disease popped up quite suddenly. This was recognized due to increasing numbers of unusual opportunistic infections and rare cancers that could be transmitted sexually, through injection drug use, from pregnant women to their babies, or through blood transfusion. CDC identified the disease as acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, or AIDS, but it wasn't until several years later that scientists figured out that a retrovirus was causing AIDS. It took years, a few name changes, many lost lives, and a mountain of hard work from many researchers, but we now know that human immunodeficiency virus is a retrovirus that attacks the body's immune system and can lead to AIDS if not treated. Now, we have heard the term retrovirus before, but what are they exactly? These viruses are enveloped, positive strand RNA viruses, and they tend to have unusual morphology and replication strategies. More specifically, retroviruses have a capsid containing two copies of a positive strand RNA genome. Back in the 1970s, scientists David Baltimore and Howard Temin showed that the retroviruses encode an RNA-dependent DNA polymerase, which is also called reverse transcriptase. Essentially, this reverse transcriptase enzyme allows the virus to make copies of DNA from RNA. At the time, the central dogma of molecular biology, as it is sometimes colorfully referred to, was the idea that genetic information is passed only from DNA to RNA, and then from RNA to protein, just as we learned when we studied transcription and translation in the biochemistry series. Baltimore and Temin's finding demonstrated that this was not exclusively the case, and their discovery ended up earning them a Nobel Prize. Among the human retroviruses, there are three subfamilies: oncovirini, which is associated with cancer and neurologic disorders; lentivirini, which includes HIV-1 and HIV-2; and spumavirini, which doesn't cause clinical disease, but does cause visible changes in infected cells. The retroviruses are classified by a few factors: the disease they cause, host range, tissue tropism, virion morphology, and genetic complexity. But let's focus specifically on HIV. Human immunodeficiency virus primarily infects CD4 T cells, which are white blood cells that fight infection, but the virus can also infect macrophages, which are another type of white blood cell. The envelope of HIV-1 has proteins that form spikes on the virion's surface, and it's these glycoproteins and transmembrane proteins that attach to a host cell and help the virus get inside. In the case of CD4 T cells, the virus causes lytic infection. With macrophages, the virus causes persistent low-level productive infection. Since the virus is killing one type of host cell altogether, the CD4 T cells, in order to make more copies of itself, it dramatically affects the immune response and ultimately leads to immunosuppression. There are multiple different pathways that the virus can take to trigger disease, depending on what cells it infects and where they are, and they are all very, very complicated. But the overall gist is this: HIV is very skilled at hiding from different components of the immune system, and one of the major factors contributing to this is its ability to repeatedly undergo mutation. Let's talk about the actual disease HIV causes. Stage 1 of HIV is an acute HIV infection, where an infected person might have flu-like symptoms, or might not show symptoms at all. During stage 1, there is a very large amount of virus in the blood, and an infected person is very contagious. Stage 2 is chronic HIV infection, which is sometimes called clinical latency, or asymptomatic HIV infection. By the end of stage 2, the amount of HIV in the blood, or the viral load, goes way up, while the CD4 cell count goes down. The most severe phase of HIV infection is stage 3, acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, or AIDS. By this point in the disease progression, someone infected with HIV has such a badly damaged immune system that they are more likely to get severe cases of opportunistic infections, and without treatment, people with AIDS typically survive about 3 years. Even though there is no cure, there are medications available to keep infections from developing to stage 3. So where did HIV come from? Scientists have determined that HIV infection in humans originated from a type of chimpanzee in Central Africa. The chimpanzee version of the virus, called Simian Immunodeficiency Virus, or SIV, got passed to humans as early as the late 1800s. Over the course of the decades that followed, HIV slowly spread across the world, and we believe that HIV has existed in the United States since the 1970s. Thinking about transmission, HIV cannot be transmitted by sharing food or drink, through pets or insects, by air or water, or through sweat or tears. There are very specific activities that can transmit HIV, including sexual activity and needle or syringe use, though the virus can also be spread from an infected mother to their child during pregnancy, birth, or breastfeeding. As of 2018, CDC estimates that 1.2 million people in the United States have HIV, with just under 40,000 new diagnoses that year alone. Worldwide, though, CDC estimates that there were 1.7 million new cases in 2018 and about 37.9 million people living with HIV. When it comes to prevention, using condoms can help, and there are a few relatively new prevention medications available, such as pre-exposure prophylaxis, or PrEP, and post-exposure prophylaxis, or PEP. For those that have HIV, the most effective treatment is antiretroviral therapy, or ART. If an infected person takes this medication as prescribed, they can stay healthy and have a very low risk of transmitting the virus to a partner. So while tremendous progress has been made in treating HIV since the 1980s, we do still have a ways to go before we are truly free of this virus.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.